many people over the years say my work is quite disturbing, it's quite dark. I always say, well, I'm so pleased to hear that. What a great thing. This is what the doctor ordered for you. So if one goes back to people like Jung, he called the dark side the shadow side. And he said very clearly, as well as many other people like him who are great psychologists, that this was the side that you had to open up, that this was the side that you had to explore. If you wanted to become a whole person, that's what you had to go back to. You had to go back to that side of yourself and find it and integrate it with your ego and your superego, and that then you would become more of a fulfilled person. And I would guess the reason that most people say these pictures are disturbing is they can't deal with their own repression. That's the real reason. I think not that the pictures are dark. The real reason is that they've kept that part of themselves hidden from themselves, and they don't want to deal with it. It's too much of a challenge. I was born in New York City in 1950. My mother, in the mid-60s, started working at Magnum, and during this time she worked with some of the most famous photographers in the world, including people like Cartier-Bresson. For many years growing up, I saw photographs all over the house, all over the walls. There were endless books, and many of these photographers visited my home. And so for maybe 6, 7, 8 years, I just got inundated with photographic images. Every day of my life, I think since maybe 17, 18 years old, I've been thinking about photography. It goes to my head, I don't know how many times each day, and God only knows what happens at nighttime. When I was younger, I guess for many years, the work had a documentary aspect to it. And I feel that this was the appropriate place to start as a photographer. And, I think that's where most people started and ended in photography for many, many years. And that was traditionally the role of a photographer, especially in the 60s and 50s, that, you know, they tried to document the world in terms of what was out there rather than what was inside in many ways. I guess beginning in the early 80s, when I started to work in the small towns of South Africa, I noticed some of my pictures somehow or another got across a certain stream, a certain river. I was quite amazed with these pictures. They were different from anything I took before. So they were like sign bearers, if you might want to call that. Something that was telling me I could get somewhere else, and it was leaving me with a strong sense of significance, those pictures. I said something to myself, these speak more of the essence of me rather than something out there. And I started to try to find a way of getting across that river more and more and staying across that river. And so I just plodded along taking pictures, and it was really a hobby. And it was a hobby up until my third book, Platteland, Images from Rural South Africa, and that was done between 86 and 94. And when I published this book, it was like a bombshell, I think. And I really wasn't prepared for this, didn't expect it. I think it was two things that created it a bombshell. You know, it's easy to say the superficial thing, that it opened up a wound in South Africa. It showed a group of people that were hidden behind propaganda, if you want to call it that, that the apartheid government didn't want to be seen to be weak, disorganized, and minimalized. And those pictures showed a group of white people that weren't able to cope, were very worried about their future. On the other hand, if that was the only concept behind these pictures, they would have never had impact. I think the pictures went way beyond that. They actually said something about the humanity's inability to cope. They said something about our inability to order the world, to not be able to act in a very effective manner. And they said something about our own marginalization, I guess, in the face of events and time itself. I think it was a good thing in a lot of ways, if I look back up on my career, because if I hadn't had this bombshell, I would have never put the time and energy into the field. It would have continued to be a hobby. And when it became, when this book, Platteland, came out and had so much impact, I sort of scratched my head a little bit and said, maybe I should start dedicating myself to photography in more than one way or another. I need to spend more time on this. All my books, for some reason or another, in a way, they all start with a word. I almost get the title to the book, or I have a pretty good idea about the title. And then I spent the next 4 or 5 years trying to define that word. So I went to a place that was a boarding house, and I tried to look at the various metaphors that might come out of this place. I mean, if you look at the most basic metaphor about a boarding house, it's a place of coming and going. It's a place of coming and going. Here 1 minute, and then you go on somewhere else. And that's pretty metaphoric for the human experience. I think this particular style that you see in the boarding house series, which is my latest book, really started to accelerate when I started to increase the amount of drawing and the pictures and painting, and the pictures became increasingly abstract and the subject started to fall away. And this photograph is called the boarding house. It's a very complex photograph. It integrates many aspects of drawing, use of line, sculpture. It uses the technique of photography to freeze time and to create meaning in this place. The photograph bite is quite interesting, this photograph, because traditionally in photography, this lower part of the picture would have been enough to make a really interesting photograph. But I think really what adds to the picture and to the ambiguity and what makes it a work of art is the line with the phone. There's something about this ambiguity that exists here in relationship to the precision and clarity of what's going on up here that creates a new meaning that makes the picture more than just something interesting or something funny or something unique. It makes it indefinable in some way or another. It's hard to understand my process in so many ways. You know, it's not something that happens in the flash of a night. You know, I go into a place, like I went into this place called the boarding house, and I don't have any particular ideas. I find something happens, something on the wall, somebody walks by, and that triggers a process. And then I have to work with that person, with that place, layer by layer. Sometimes it happens automatically, very quickly, and I put the things together. Ultimately, a photographer like myself is a visual organizer. I'm a visual integrator. I'm not an objectifier. I guess I would like to say that. That's quite an important concept. Most people see the camera as an objectifying instrument. Well, I think that's completely nonsense. A camera is not an objectifying instrument. It's a recording instrument. What you see through a camera is camera reality. As you know, there's no such thing as objective reality. Reality is reality. There's no one way of defining it, this word. But when I take pictures, I work within the situation. I try to layer the photograph, if you want to use those words. I try to make it very complex. I guess that's the balance that I try to get in my pictures, is a balance between precision, clarity, and complexity. I am quite completely confident that I don't have to worry about being inspired, don't have to worry about an environment. I say to myself, I've been on this planet now for over 59 years. I get 59 years of experience, images, dreams, things in my mind to work with. There's plenty there. I have 59 years to unravel on this planet, plus what was there is a in my id, which is probably goes back a billion or 2 years. So I really don't have to worry about finding images out there. Everything I need is inside. Just the ability to find those things and integrate them is the difficult part. The process of taking pictures is like going down a mine. You know, over my career as a geologist, I've been in many deep level mines. I've gone down maybe 2 kilometers in the gold mines in South Africa. So I gotta go in my own self, metaphorically speaking. I gotta go down, 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 get down there. But that's the first step. So you get down into your mind, you go deep into yourself. But the next hard process is you gotta bring whatever's down there up and then materialize it. And that's very difficult in photography.